Welcome to Flames of Revival broadcast. This is Shelby Vaughn, Pastor Full Gospel Tabernacle, 208 Washington Street in Anahuac, Texas. I'm so glad you're tuning in today. I praise God that he is good all the time. You know, we have a wonderful, wonderful God, and he just wants to get to know you better. If you'll just let God know you better, if you'll just let God get in your business, if you'll let God spend time with you, you spend time with him. If you'll respect the ministry of the Holy Spirit, and let him teach you some things, you will have a wonderful life. Then when the enemy come in like a flood, the Spirit of God raises up a standard against him. And so the attack, it can't last but so long. You know, whatever you're going through right now, it can't last but so long. Ain't no big deal. You know what I'm saying? A lot of stuff we face, it's just another day in the neighborhood. That's just what happens. It ain't no big deal, for real. And so you are always triumphant. And so you don't keep looking at the problems and you don't keep looking at the circumstance. You look at God who made the promise, okay? And so today, I want to talk to you. And we quote it all the time. The Bible says, how can two walk together except they be in agreement? And so today, I want to talk to you. The place of agreement is the place of power, all right? So that's what I want to talk to you about. The place of agreement is the place of power. So whenever I agree with God, power is released. Whatever God said is going to happen, as I obey, because I agree, power is released. And so, whether you talk about ministry, you might be in business. Your ministry may be to coach a little league basketball team, a football team, a baseball team. Your ministry might be to cook food. Whatever your ministry is, if you agree with God in that ministry, because that's ministry too. See, God don't need everybody be a preacher. Got it? God don't need everybody in the pulpit. God needs people out there that do other stuff. We need Christians everywhere, in every industry. You understand? It's pleasing to God. We need believers everywhere. And so what you need to understand is there's an anointing that God sends to help you become successful in all that you do. And so I want to kind of throw some things at you and give you some things to consider. Okay. So let me just start making a few statements right now. First statement I want to make is this. The future is not ahead. Theoretically it is, but it's not. The future is not ahead. The future is within. Okay? Whatever future you're going to have that you plan for yourself or whatever you got, you know, I'm going to do this, I'm going to start a business or whatever, whatever. That's not out there. That's in here. So the future is not ahead, the future is within. And so the Bible says that God, just like God sends us, just like it rains and it comes down and waters the earth, it says, so shall my word be that goes forth out of my mouth, it shall not return void, but it shall accomplish what I sent it to accomplish, and it'll do what I said it's going to do. Now notice, he said, just like the rain comes down and waters the earth, and it makes the seed, you know, grow in bud, flowers grow in blood and all that. It says, so shall my word be. And so what he's trying to tell us is if we would just pay attention to his spirit and his word, let his word do a work on the inside of us. If you let his word, you know, and let me tell you something, because I know people, they don't get it, but let me tell you something. You ain't got to live in church, you know, you don't have to, because I enjoy this so much, sometimes people think this is all I do. Well, this is my number one. This is my heart. You understand? But you could have a normal life. You can go shopping. I play golf and I hunt deer. And, you know, you understand what I'm saying? But when it's time for me to work on my assignment, then I put that aside and do what I'm supposed to do. So the Bible says seek first the kingdom, God's order, God's method, God's way of doing things. And it says everything else will be added to you. And so God wants to add to your life because you walk in agreement with him. So the place of agreement is the place of power. Whenever men all over the scripture agree with God, power was released every single time, okay? And so if you want a manifestation of the supernatural, if you want the anointing to come down wherever you are, if you want the eternal to invade your life, then you need to pay attention to what God is putting on the inside of you. You need to pay attention to this God who loves you and took care of you. See, God got his hand on you, and he says, if you seek me, you will find me when you seek me with all of your heart. And so God is waiting on you to draw close. He said, if you draw close to me, I will draw close to you. But the place of agreement is the place of power. Now, you know, like, give example. On the day of Pentecost, okay, well, the invitation was made to 500, but just 120 showed up. Well, guess who got filled with the Holy Ghost? Clove of tongues like as a fire, rushing mighty wind. Guess who ever, they start speaking in tongues. Guess who experienced that? The one who agreed with him. They were the ones that was in the upper room. All right, watch this. Give and it shall be given unto you. And I got some stuff on prosperity too. You know, give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall men give into your bosom. You understand what I'm saying? Watch this. Death and life is in the power of your tongue. Okay? I remember one time, I'm going to just tell you this, and I'm going to keep moving, but the place of agreement is the place of power. So when God is trying to give you a revelation on what you need to do to change what is, then you got to agree with him. Okay? You understand? So let's say, and he had never told me to do that, but if he did, I'd do it. But let's say God told you, you say, I'm believing God for that new car, and God say, go to the showroom floor, lay hands on it, and speak to it in Jesus' name. And or stand there and say, it's mine, it's mine, it's mine, it's mine, it's mine, 7 times, and then go home. If he told me to do that, I would do it. Well, he might be telling, see, watch this. Once I agree, if that's what he told me to do, once I agree with him and I start doing that, once I release that and did that, then the power shows up to transfer that title into my hands. See, this is supposed to work. Understand what I keep telling you? This is supposed to work. And so, if I will, his voice and his word agree together. God is not a man, he should lie. And so, I need to spend time in the word. You got it? That's first. And then I need to let this word convince me that this is true. I told you that's how I got healed. My twisted back. I just kept looking at the word. By stripes you are healed. Man, I'm healed. Hoo-wee. Now, I understand. Physically, I wasn't healed, but spiritually, I was. And I'm thinking, man, by his stripes, I'm healed. Because the doctor said there ain't no cure. But you know what? He says, by stripes, you are healed. Then I read another scripture that says, by his stripes, you were healed. I say, so if I was healed, I'm healed. And then, okay, wait a minute, wait, let me see. And then I read, and that's what I do to all my Bibles, just tie them up. But that's all right. I got about 14 of them. Some of them knew I ain't even really looked at yet, so I'm good. But anyway, come on, man. But anyway, and then I read in the scripture where it says, Jesus Christ the same, yesterday, today, and forever. And that right there, and it just kept on. And I'm like, look, I'm telling you, I'm taking pills. I'm going to the doctor. I'm going to the med center. I'm going to chiropractor. They trying to get my it's like somebody was trying to break my back before I got healed. I was 19. You understand? I've been healed ever since I got healed. But anyway, it was just, you know, I started agreeing with that. I wasn't agreeing with my back no more. I was agreeing with this. Well, by stripes I'm healed. Okay, well, so he already did the stripes. So Psalms 107 verse 20, send his word and heal him. Okay, so the word can heal. He already died on the cross. He already paid the price for my healing. Okay, so that means, well, but as a need of healing, if we believe the word, we can have access, and he can use his word to heal us. And so I was just, you know, like a scientist. I was studying the word, and I was speaking. I said, Lord, I thank you that I'm healed. Then I take my pills. Yes, I would. I said, Lord, I thank you that by your stripes, I'm healed. You understand? Sometimes couldn't sit but so long and had to twist and do all kinds of crazy stuff. Had boards under my mattress and all of that, but I kept agreeing with it. I said, Lord, and so I'm thanking him every day. I said, I thank you that I'm healed, Lord, because I ain't going to be no crippled preacher. Oh, no. I'm not going to be bent over like no old lady. So I thank you, Lord, that by your stripes, I'm healed. You got it? You understand? And I said it, and I said it, and I believed it. I really did believe it. You know what I mean? I don't care how bad it hurt. So I quit paying attention to the hurt and started paying attention. I said, man, I wonder when this going to come through. Not in doubt. I was just getting excited because I was anticipating healing flowing to me. And then one day, unexpectedly, out of the blue, I'm sitting in the back. And Sister Wilborn had a word that come from God, and because I never told her about my back. And she said, there's somebody here, you have a twisted spine, and God will heal you right now. I'm sitting in the back. They have revival people in the front. So I'm sitting in the back. I ain't never seen nothing like this. Never heard of it, never read it, never saw it on TV, none of that. So I'm sitting in the back, and I said, oh, man. I said, okay, so I'm going to sit here, and whoever she's talking to, I'm going to let them go up. And then once they go up and she pray for them, then I'm going to go up and ask her to pray for me. That's what I'm saying in the back. So it wasn't nobody moving. So I'm back there fussing. I said, man, I'm looking around at everybody. I can't believe this. They heard what the lady said. Everybody in there heard what she said. And ain't nobody moving. They heard what she said. I'm fussing. And so then she said, she waited a little while and she said it again. She said, oh, you might as well come on up because you here. She was on a fast. She said, God showed me you here, and I'm telling you, that pain you got where there ain't no cure and your back twisted, if you come up, God will heal you right now. Didn't nobody move because I didn't know she was talking to me yet. And I said, I cannot. Glory. I'm looking up there. I said, I'm looking around at everybody from the back. I said, I cannot believe it. I mean, I put that emphasis on. I'm saying it to myself. I cannot believe this. I'm looking all around. Man, I can't believe this. I can't believe this, man. They heard her. How come nobody get up? And then everything got quiet, left my head. And this presence came, and right behind my ear, this voice said, she's talking to you. I said, oh! And I got up and went and got prayer, and I got healed. For real. Power went, and I told you the story, and I got healed, you know. Then later on for jobs and stuff, I went to the doctors and got x-rays and all that. I said, I'm my back. I didn't ever tell them why I was asking or whatever. I said, it's normal like everybody else. I said, okay. I was 19, and it's been healed ever since that day. So now, how did it get healed? Because the other doctor said there was no cure. He said that for somebody that wasn't born like that, he had never seen a spine twisted that bad. And by the time I was 30, I was going to walk around like an old woman. So whatever I was going to do, you know, they're going to put me in the car, take me out, and you know what I'm saying? He said, because it's twisting fast. And so instead of just sitting there and dying and sitting there and being crippled, I fought back. So my deal with you is you ought to fight back. If the Bible says give and it shall be given to you, you ought to be sowing seed. He said, wealth and riches going to be in my house. You understand what I'm saying? I remember one time I was out of a job, and I wasn't even getting no unemployment because they set me up. So you had to go find a minimum wage job and make so much and to release your unemployment. And the kids was real little then, and I was like, man. And I remember this guy was on TV, and he was just wanting $10 to support his ministry a month. And God spoke to me and said, I want you to send him $10. I said, okay. And I did. And I started sending the $10. And, you know, I don't even know where I was getting $10 from because it was rough for a season. But every time I'd give, I felt good. I didn't have no more. But I felt good. And I kept saying, you said give and it shall be given. And then you said I could decree a thing. So then I started figuring out where I wanted to work. You understand? It didn't matter whether he was hiring or not. I wanted to work right there. And from that day until God called me full time, every job I wanted, every plant I wanted to work in, every spot I wanted to work in, I mean every single one, I worked in it. It didn't matter whether it was hiring or not because that seed was opening doors. And I'm thinking, all my years I ain't been able to do this. A lot of places I wanted to get in, I couldn't get in, and they was hiring. But now I'm in company. See, the place of agreement was the place of power. I worked in DuPont. I said, Lord, I want to work at DuPont in Beaumont. That was years ago. I said, I want to work there. I don't know nobody there. I ain't never worked there. I want to work there for a season. And I did. Went right there, got right hired right on. I'm telling you right now. And then I went full-time, told God when I wanted to go full-time and all. And he told me he was going to tell me because it was getting time. And then that was it. You understand? And for the last, since the year 2000, you know, I get up every day and do what I want to do. You understand what I'm saying? And you can tell I ain't lost no weight or nothing, not yet. But anyway, you can tell, you know, I just, for 17 years, I don't even know how God took care of me. I don't even know how he did that. You understand? Because I bought cars, about three houses. You know what I mean? Sold one, got another one I'm going to sell. And one I'm in right now. And probably going to sell that and get another. You understand my point? But for 17 years, this is 17 as we record this, for 17 years, because I left in the month of February, like he told me, in the year 2000, every day I get up and do what I want to do. Every day. And I don't know how God is sending me money and taking care of me. I know some of it, but a lot of them tough times for about 7, 8 years, I don't have a clue. I honestly don't, how I paid the bills and kept on. But he's just been taking care of me because that's what he said. And so the place of agreement is the place of power. Okay? So now I'm in another season in my life where God said, okay, it's time for you now to go all over the world. Get ready to go all over the world. I'm going to send you all over the world. Signs and miracles and wonders will take place because I'm going to send you all over the world. See, now I'm telling you because that's what he said. Now guess what I'm doing? I'm agreeing with him. Lord, I thank you that I'm all over the world. I thank you that you're sending me all over the world. And that's what I say. I say it, and I say it, and I praise God, and I see it, and I say it, and you'll see it. You understand what I'm saying? One time when I needed some money, God said, okay, I want you to sow this seed to them, sow this seed to them. And the people I'm sowing to, they don't need my money. I'm already a tither and a giver in my own church. But God was telling me where to sow and which direction to go in. And all these people he was telling me to sow to, oh, they wealthy for real. They didn't need a dime from me. But it wasn't about them, it was about me. So I agreed with God. And he said, now I want you to start confessing money that you need. I said, okay, Lord, I think it's somebody got on my mind, give me $500. Somebody give me $1,000. And I just kept going up, went to 10,000, you know, and just kept going up, you know. You know what I mean? Till a million. Now, I ain't got my million yet and all of that. But every time, you know, after so long a time, somebody hand me $500, say the Lord told me. Somebody else would. Somebody said the Lord told me to give you 1,000. Somebody else said the Lord told me to give you 1,000. One man said the Lord told me to give you 10,000, and he did. You understand what I'm saying? And all I did was say what God said. And so now I'm fine. I don't just know it, but I really know it by experience. This word of God is true. You understand? Now, let me say what I've been saying all the time. This is supposed to work. So if you're obeying this and it ain't working, why don't you ask the Holy Ghost to show you what you left out or what is it that's blocking, because we're not wrestling with flesh and blood. Ask God to show you what's blocking your next level blessing. Ask God to show you what's blocking. You could have bitterness, unforgiveness, or whatever, and that could block your money. That could block your promotion. That could block your favor. You understand? Because the devil is a legalist, and he uses the word and accuses you before God. God, your word says so and so and so. They're rebelling against you. You kick me out of heaven because I rebel, so you can't bless them. You see what I'm saying? And so that's really the way it works. And you know what? I wanted to tell you something else, too, for real. Well let me read this first. Yeah, let me read this first, and I want to tell you something else before I run out of time. In Mark 4, verse 26, here's what it says. Jesus talking about the seed. Here's what he said. And he said, so is the kingdom of God, as if a man should cast seed into the ground, and should sleep and rise night and day, and the seed should spring up and grow up. He knoweth not how. For the earth brings forth of herself first the blade, then the ear, after that the full corn in the ear. But when the fruit is brought forth, immediately he put it in the sickle, because the harvest is come. So you plant seed, it said, and it's growing, and you don't have to know how. So you don't have to know how God going. I don't have to know how God going to get me all over the world. I don't have to know that. I don't have to know how God going to give me the new car, bless me or whatever. I don't have to know none of that. So since I'm in the realm of knowledge about what his word says, two walking together, how can they walk together except they agree? So I'm in agreement with him. Then I don't need to know the rest of it. I don't have to know how. Got it? You understand? And I don't know how. But I don't have to know how. I just have to know this is what he said. So the seed that's planted determines what I'm going to get back. Not me. The planted seed in the kingdom, in the will of God, determines what God grows up and sends back to me. Not my own effort, my own strength, my own know-how, none of that. It's me aligning with the word of God, because God is not a man that he should lie. And so the Bible says that, let give example. The Bible says he sent his word and healed them. So the word is stronger than sickness. You understand? The word of faith is stronger than anything. Nothing is impossible to the one that believes. And so once I understand that, I just need to keep finding some scriptures so I can keep agreeing with it. You understand what I'm saying? Now, give example. Another example. And you know this. When Joshua and Caleb, you know, and all, you know, Moses, all his folks and all that, they were supposed to go in. Do you understand that Joshua and Caleb wasn't the only one that was supposed to go in? Everybody was supposed to go in, but everybody didn't. Watch this. All of us supposed to be blessed. All of us supposed to have more than enough. All of us supposed to be blessed with creative ideas. All of us supposed to walk in power. All of us, not just a certain church, certain denomination, certain group. All of us supposed to be blessed. You understand? So if I'm not being blessed and this is not working because it's supposed to work, then I need to find out, what am I doing wrong? How am I thinking? And you know what? The Holy Ghost will tell me where I'm getting off. He'll tell me what's blocking the blessing, what's holding me up. He'll tell you. You understand? And so when you start, if you're going to serve God and read the Bible, I think you ought to believe it. I think you ought to believe it all. And I'm going to give you this other nugget that I meant to give you earlier. You know, when God told, when Daniel told the people in that day, he said, we don't want to eat none of the king's dainty meats and all of that. You know, so we want to eat vegetables and stuff. And then in 10 days, we'll see who's the smartest, whether your guys and your magicians, whatever. If y'all smarter, are we smarter? And the scripture says these guys that honored God and honored, you know, as far as diet is concerned, the plan of God for them, then they found out they were 10 times smarter than the other guys. And I thought about that. I said, you know what? I think that you can go in, let's say, to a new job, and you can use this same principle, same law, and I think you ought to do it, really. And God could do something to your thinking and make you 10 times smarter than the people you work for. Or if y'all all new hires and you go in with them, I think you use your faith, and God can make you 10 times smarter than everybody else that work on that job. I think you could use your faith to accelerate your learning. I really do. I think that if it's a task that you need to learn and something you need to know, let's say you was going to school to be an aircraft mechanic or a regular mechanic, I believe God can put something in your heart and in your mind to where you start understanding how all that stuff works. And I believe God can make you smarter and pick that stuff up without strain and stress and struggle if you'll use your faith to learn. And I believe God can let you rise to the top in the industry that you don't know nothing about. But you got to believe it, and you got to have faith for it. And so, because I got some experiments that I'm about to do based on what I'm telling you. So I'm thinking, Lord, you know what? There's a lot of stuff I ain't even tried yet, because now I'm thinking about it differently from the way I ever thought about it before. So I believe in a foreign language, or learn to play the piano, or whatever it is. I believe if you believe God, ask God, trust God, I believe God can take the skill you got now, take the brain you got now, and I believe God can do something to you supernaturally so it's easy for you to understand, to remember, and to learn something that you never learned before. Think about it. He did it with them. I think he could, because he ain't no respect of person, see? I'm telling you. And so I'm thinking differently. Like, you know what? Okay, Lord. Yeah, why not make God your partner? And why not trust him? You know what I mean? For real now. I'm not playing. You know, so let me go back to the piano. What if you want to play the piano? For real. And you want to play for your church and all of that. I think you could pray. I think you can confess scriptures that your mind is clear and you're thinking, and God give you creative ideas and creative way to learn and all. And I believe you can confess that word over and over again as you practice, because faith without works is dead. And I believe God can put it in. In fact, I went to college with a guy. He never took a piano lesson in his life. He said when he was 14, he saw a revival. He saw people playing and all. And he said, you know what, Lord, I want to play the piano. So he told his pastor, he said, you know, I want to play the piano. And his church went on the fast, and the kids was eating like once a day, something like that. And he said that during the revival and all, you know, he was in there with his mama and everybody else. And he said, the pastor walked up to him one day and said, go get on that piano and play. And he said, okay. So he got up. He's 14. He ain't never took a lesson. He said, so when they start singing songs, this is what he, the way he described it. You know, he gone on to be with the Lord now. But this is the way he described it to me. He said it felt like somebody put their hand in his hand, like a glove. And when they start singing them notes, he just knew which fingers to use. And he would do it over and over again. And then he could add little runs. You know, our piano, y'all know what I'm talking about. And he could add, make it sound real good and all. He's 14. He said, but on that fast, because it asked God, God let him learn right now instead of taking him 10 months or 6 months, or however long it takes somebody to really learn to play the piano. He said he learned it in one night. So why not? Why not try this? You understand? Whatever industry you're in, and you might like your job. You might be on that job right now, and you like it. Why not? You know, why not use your faith and say, okay, God, you know, and find you some scripture like that? Because I'm going to do it, so I ain't playing. But I got another area that I'm working on. But I'm telling you right now, why not? Why? What? Why not? You know what I'm talking about? You know, why not? Why not? Why not? Why not? See, so now it's like, okay, I'm going to adventures in faith now. So now, for the rest of my life, I'm going to be doing my own adventures in faith for Shelby. Because the Bible says he will increase you more and more. And the Bible says we go from faith to faith. And the Bible says without faith, it's impossible to please God. So you ought to never get to the point where you don't need no more faith stuff. You know, well, I got that. I wanted a house, so I got it. And I don't need to use my faith for nothing else. No. I think you ought to use your faith for something else, and use your faith for something else. And if you don't need nothing else, use your faith to get a whole lot to give away. You know what I mean? You might want to build some churches. I want to build 10 churches in the Philippines. It's one of the things I'm working on. I'm going to work on. I don't know why. I ain't never been to the Philippines. Don't know nobody there. Don't know nobody there. But this desire came one day. I was on the fast. It's years ago. I didn't know what I know now. And I just said, you know, I'd like to build 10 churches in the Philippines. And that never left me. And a day going to come when I build 10 churches in the Philippines. And I don't know no preachers in the Philippines. I don't know nobody in the Philippines, as far as I know. I don't know nobody. But I just want to do that. I want to bless them with 10 churches. Okay? So now, like I say, but I'm working on something else first. You know, that'll help with that even. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to stand on these scriptures and all, and I'm going to say, God, you know the end result is of this. I want to build them 10 churches in the Philippines, but I'm using my faith for this so it'll work so I can do that without strain, stress, or struggle. So I'm going to do just what I'm telling you to do. Got it? I'm going to get me these adventures in the faith. And I'm going to say, okay. And I'm going to claim, just like I did when I'm by my back out here, same thing. I'm going to claim that, okay, Lord, according to this scripture, you give me creative ideas. And the favor is on me. And I'm going to tell you something else. What is it? I think it's Ezekiel 36, I believe. Exodus 36, if you read verses 1 through 7, Exodus 36, 1 through 7, you will see how the Bible says, and God put in the heart of the men that he sent to help Moses, he put skill in them, you know, and some talents in them for them to be, or something like that, for them to learn how to help Moses. And it said, and then Moses called him and all, it said, and he called the ones who God sent to help him, and God put ideas in them because that desire was to help Moses. So you might want to help your pastor, but you can't play the piano, you don't know how to count money, you don't know nothing. But if you'll pray and your desire to help your pastor and your church, I believe God can put an idea in you where you can believe God, and he'll put a skill in you to help the church or the youth or the ministry or whatever. But if you'll read that and meditate on that, because that's a set of scriptures that I'm going to use too, you know, where it kept saying, and then the people were so good at it, and God started blessing them, it says that they went out to get together the money, you know, to do what God told them to do. And Moses said, y'all bring too much money, so go stop them, because we don't need no more offering. I said, boy, what a wonderful problem. Boy, I like that problem. You know, well, they bring so much until I have to stop them. You know what I'm saying? But glory to, yeah, I ain't playing with that. You understand? So what I'm telling you is, why not? Adventures in faith. And then what you going to do with that faith you got? All this faith you got, what you going to do with it? I think you ought to be a world changer. Use the faith to build you a hotel. You understand what I'm saying? A cattle ranch or whatever. But do something with your faith. And if you don't need all the revenue and all of that, bless somebody else, okay? And if you just don't have nobody else to bless, bless Shelby Varner right here, okay? All right. I had fun today. I'm so glad you tuned in. Thank you for tuning in. God bless you. This is Shelby Varner from Anahuac, Texas. Remember, you got what it takes. It takes what you've got to change the world. God bless you. I'm going to see you next time on the air.